pronounced at the lotus feet of Bhagavan. Dear brothers and sisters, welcome back to Sai Pearls of Wisdom session. After a gap for about 6 months or so, we are meeting here for the first time. I am extremely happy and grateful to Swami for having made the Sai Pearls quite popular. People have been browsing their computers and have been expressing their satisfaction about it, because this information is not accessible to everybody. Not that I am unique in making this presentation, it's not that. As the matter is not accessible to everybody, as everyone is quite anxious to know what is being transacted there in the veranda between Swami and the students, this has been catching up day by day. I thank all of you for the keen interest you have been showing and the encouragement that you have been giving me from time to time to continue this project. From now on, we begin part 22 of Sai Pearls of Wisdom. So far 21 parts have been there, and this is the 22nd. We commence from the month of August, year 2003. Because Swami came here in the month of July, around 9th. And sessions started only in the month of August. Because in the earlier period, as you know, it could not be possible for us to interact with him. But later, slowly and slowly, it is only in the month of August that he preferred to spend some time with us. And what all that had happened on 11th of August 2003, I want to bring to your attention few of the important points. Around that time, under the auspices of Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning, we had a symposium for school teachers. As you know, Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning has been adjudged as the best in the country. And the University Grants Commission requested Sri Satya Sai University to conduct some orientation courses to school teachers so that they will try to apply values in their teaching as well as in practice. So it is in the direction. We had a symposium for teachers from different schools, around 50 of them selected, the first batch. And teachers, professors here from Satya University, they were given topics, and each one was to deal on a particular topic. Well, I should say, with least of exaggeration, that the entire symposium went on very, very well, much to the satisfaction of the organizers and also the participants as well. It is in that connection, conversation took place there that evening on the 11th of August 2003. As it was long time past that ever since we have had Bhagavan in our midst, naturally we were thrilled to have him again in our midst. We were very much excited to find him sitting on the chair and talking to every one of us, because a couple of months we were away from him physically. And Bhagavan was equally happy to talk to us that day, that he exceeded even bhajan time, which rarely happens. As bhajan time is nearing, about 5 minutes before bhajan, he winds up the talk, conversation, and then proceeds towards the bhajan hall, which he does often. But this time, the conversation went on even beyond the time, meaning we also took some bhajan time sessions also. It speaks of the eagerness of the students and the love of Bhagavan. And Bhagavan started asking her some questions. He looked straight at me and said, "What was your topic? On what topic did you speak to those teachers?" I said, "Bhagavan, I spoke on the unity of religions." "Oh, I see." Then Swami puts a question. "How do you explain this unity? What are the examples that you have given in support of your topic, unity? What are things that you have given? How did you deal the subject?" I answered this way, "Bhagavan, your discourse has come to my rescue every time. All the valuable things that I hear and the pearls that I collect from your lotus feet would be of immense value to me. That would be quite handy, which I make use of that literature." And then I started telling like this, "Bhagavan, I explained 6 major religions. 2, I explained on the basis of values, not on the basis of rituals. Religions differ so far as rituals are concerned, but religions are united. Religions have that harmony when we take spirituality into consideration. If you go by rituals, we are divided. If you think of spirituality, we stand united." That's what I said. "For instance, Swami, truth, righteousness, peace, love, non-violence, all the values that you talk to us are common to all religions. Therefore, when we are value-based, we will be able to arrive at unity." That's what I said. "Swami, I could recall what all that you said in this line, and I could share with those teachers that day." Swami did not leave me at that stage. Further, he said, "What are the religions that you speak on?" "Swami, 6 major religions." "What are they?" "Yes, these are the following 6 religions: Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Christianity, Islam, and Sikhism." Sikh. "These are the 6 major religions followed in this country." So I dealt on these 6 religions as they are quite popular in this country. Then Swami said, "Okay, how did you proceed? When you could think of all the 6 religions, what procedure you have adopted?" Then I said, "Swami, 3 points. 1, important points of each of these 6 religions. Point 2, basic values like truth, righteousness, non-violence, peace and love, what every religion has got to say on these values." That's the second. 3, Bhagavan's views on each of these religions. I made a tabular form, "Swami, principles first, next about these values, what they tell, and finally, Swami's views on these religions." Well, I could find an expression of satisfaction on his face. And then, however, Bhagavan said, "What are the examples you have given to speak to them that unity of religions is necessary? How could you prove that there is unity? What examples you have given?" I said, "Swami, I take an example from your literature. Gold is same, but jewels are many. Flowers are many, worship is same. Out of the same clay, so many pots are made. Gold is one, paths are many. Sky is one, stars are many." You gave number of examples, Swami. I cited all of them, and they seem to have been convinced. Then Swami put a very pertinent question here. "Where have you learned this unity of religions?" where have you learned? Swami, I must admit, I have learned after coming to you. Oh, how could you learn? You say that you have learned unity of religions after coming to me, that's all right. How did you learn? How could you learn? I said, Swami, the place itself conveys sufficient message. As we come over here to this place, we first come across Sri Satyasai Hillview Stadium, where we have statues of Krishna, Lord Shiva, Jesus Christ, Guru Nanak, Lord Buddha, all these statues, 20 feet, 30 feet in height, speak of unity of religions. Passing by, we come across Chaitanya Jyoti, which speaks of unity of religions and the principles through charts and computer presentations. And then we get into Prashanthanilayam, there is Sarva Dharma Stupa, which is a symbol of unity of all religions, where there is a pillar and a lotus flower above. You must have seen there in Prashanthanilayam, behind Purnachandra Auditorium. That pillar with a lotus flower is a symbol of unity of religions. On all the five sides, you find important points of all the religions have been depicted on the wall. They have been carved on the wall. So Sarvadharma Stupa also speaks of unity of religions. As we get into Purnachandra Auditorium, we find all these things on the wall, embossed. Christ is surrounded by sheep. The Guru Granth, the holy book of Sikhism, the holy fire of Zoroaster, Lord Krishna talking to Arjuna, all these things embossed, beautiful paintings on the wall. Then Purnachandra Auditorium also speak of unity of religions. This place itself has got a message based on the unity of religions. I have learnt it here only, Swami, that's what I said. And then Swami said, all right, you say unity is there, explain how diversity has come out of this. Explain how diversity has come out of unity. You have been explaining so well how there is unity. Very good. Why diversity now? Well, all the stock with me is exhausted. I had to lift both of my hands in helplessness. Then there is no other alternative other than to surrender to the lotus feet. Then Swami started speaking on this topic. Look here. You have ears, you have eyes, hands and legs. All these limbs of your body belong to you only. Hands, legs, nose, ears, they belong to you. Limbs, organs are many, but they belong to you, is it not? Similarly, all these religions are like limbs. They all speak about the same God. They all speak of the same God. That is unity, that's what Bhagavan has said. And further, if you know one person clearly, you'll be able to know everybody else. You'll be able to know everybody else. Simple example. In medicine, during the period of study, every medical graduate studies the parts of a single person. The same parts are present everywhere. The eye structure of me is same as the eye structure of you. The ear structure of me, of mine, is same as the ear structure of you as well. Similarly, if you know one, you'll be knowing everyone. That is what unity is. That's what Bhagavan has said. Therefore, though there are so many bulbs illumining, shedding light, that the brilliant current behind is one and the same. That's how you can certainly establish unity, as Bhagavan has said. And then, Swami, all right, a simple question. What is it, Swami? Swami, this is my question. How to achieve unity? I have known unity theoretically. Diversity is what I see. But how to achieve unity? How to attain unity? That's my question. And Bhagavan said, that principle which is not seen is responsible for the functioning of the whole of the body that you see. The hands that you see, they work because of divinity. Legs you walk because of divinity. Eyes see because of divinity. So these limbs are seen, but the divinity is unseen. When you think of that unseen, single principle of divinity, naturally you can attain unity. We are not able to understand the unity because our vision, our understanding is divided. But we don't think of the main source. If you think of the main source, naturally you will attain unity. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then, Swami, I made one comment. Because every occasion we want to exhibit our scholarship or knowledge in a foolish way and get into a problem. That's what happens, particularly with Swami. One has to be very careful. But I am known for these things, putting questions every time. Because I can extract some information from Swami which will be useful to everybody. At times the questions may look quite silly, out of context and irrelevant. But yet the matter I get thereafter will be of immense value to everybody. Now I said, there is one character in Bhagavata by name Prahalada. Prahalada. This boy, Prahalada, said to his father, "Oh father, I could know marma, M-A-R-M-A, Sanskrit word, marma, see, of the whole knowledge, M-A-R-M-A, marma, of the whole knowledge." Baba caught hold of my neck now. Then he said, "What is the meaning of marma?" Then I said, "Swami, essence." Essence. Prahlada said, "I could know the marma of education," meaning I could know the essence of education. Baba said, "No. It is not essence. It is a secret. Marma means a secret of education." And then he said, "Oh, I see. Now tell me the secret of education," he asked me. "What shall I say?" "Swami, I don't know anything else other than that what I remember. I don't know anything else other than what you said, which I happen to hear and translate. What can I do, Swami?" He said, "Nothing wrong. Tell what you know. Come on." He insisted that I should say. "All right, Swami, I'll quote your own poem. I'll quote your own poem here." Swami said, "Tell, what is there?" "Swami, one time you said, the essence of all sacred texts all over the world can be summarized into a single sentence, which is the secret of education. What is that?" "The same self is present in everybody. The self in you is same as the self in everyone. That is the secret of education. Oh, Swami, so simple. And then further Swami commented, correct. Why do you hesitate to tell that what you know? Why are you afraid to tell that what you feel correct? Correct answer you have given. Then Swami said, what did you have in the college? Swami, we had a symposium in the college. Now he started asking questions. What is a symposium? What is a symposium? Oh, I see. We should have to give the answer. Swami, symposium is a process, is a phenomenon where different perspectives, different viewpoints on a single topic are projected by different people, by participants. The theme is one. On the single theme, people present different viewpoints, different aspects. Swami said, no, you are wrong. Yes, good, good. Then Swami, what else is symposium? Then Swami says, you are wrong. Symposium is not division. You say different points are the same, you are wrong. You are not dividing the subject. Division is not symposium. Union is symposium. Sim, S-Y-M, sim means union. Symposium, where people unite. Not as you say, they divide. So you are wrong, they unite. Oh, I see, Swami. Alright, then Bhagavan said, Swami, what should I do? What practice should I follow to experience this spirit of symposium, unity? What should I do? Unity. What should I do? Then I just give some more points for Swami to speak on, to provocate him and to get some bangings in turn. Swami, people say that japa or penance, dhyana, meditation, puja, worship, prayer are different paths, are different spiritual exercises to attain unity. Which one should I follow? Swami said, none of them. None of them? Yes. Swami, so what should I do now? What shall I do now? Baba said, inquiry. Inquiry. The path of inquiry. Put to yourself the question, who am I? I am not the body. I am not the mind. I am not the intellect. I am the self. Self-inquiry is the only path to attain unity. That's what Baba said. But I don't want to keep quiet at that stage. So, Swami, do you mean to say that meditation is useless? Do you mean to say that worship is fit for nothing process? So, shall I stop all these things? That's the question I said. Then Baba said these things. No. These are all the processes that will make you fit enough to inquire yourself. I think I am clear. By meditation, your mind will develop concentration, which will help you to make self-inquiry. By worship, mind becomes pure, fit enough for self-inquiry. So all the paths which you are adopting, they make the ground ready. They make the mind ready to turn inward, proceed along the path of inquiry. So see that is the uniqueness of Baba. He says one thing, at the same time he does not reject the other things. They are also necessary to have this. That is Bhagavan Baba. I think I am clear. Therefore, self-inquiry is very necessary. Only path. But for that, meditation, bhajan, these are all necessary. Because it makes you fit enough, ready, equip you. That's what Bhagavan said. Swami, excellent. And then, Swami, I've got one more question. What is it? Swami, people say that the path of inquiry is the path of wisdom, jnana, which is superior most, which is the highest level of spirituality. So, is it enough if I proceed in that direction? Because the highest level, non-stop air flight, non-stop. Fine. Why change over then Bombay, Frankfurt, none is straight. So Swami, shall I proceed along the path of inquiry, which is the path of wisdom, jnana yoga, straight away? Because people say it is most superior. Baba said, no, you are wrong again. Even in the path of wisdom, there is present action, karma. There is also present bhakti or devotion. Even in the path of wisdom, these two are there. Bhakti, devotion, and karma, action, both of them are there. Because mere wisdom is only collection of facts, knowledge, if there is no action. Mere wisdom makes you arrogant if there is no wisdom. So wisdom will find its fulfillment. Wisdom will find its fructification if only coupled with action and devotion. That's what Bhagavan has said. Anyway, I wanted to put another question. Swami, excuse me for putting this question. Anyhow, would you please let me know what is the best method in spiritual practice, sadhana, among different ways in spiritual practice? What is the best way? What is the most suitable way? Which is higher than the other? Because we want to be high in life always, you know. Which is superior? Please let me know. Baba said, remember always, there is nothing like one being superior, other being inferior in spirituality. There is nothing like higher level and lower level. The higher and superior are only competitive, comparative words used in the worldly parlance or worldly sense. But in spirituality, there is nothing like superior and inferior. There is nothing like higher level and lower level. Everything is same. That's what you have to understand. Swami, how am I to know? I think I am a bit higher than others. Bit higher. Because I am sitting on a chair. No, Baba said, if you stand in waters knee deep, you can see and talk to everybody. If you are in water neck deep, you can still talk to everybody. If you drown yourself totally, you cannot communicate anything to anybody. Similarly, the ultimate experience is silence. The ultimate experience is silence. So long you speak superior and inferior, you have not got anything. When you remain silent, when you remain speechless, that is the attainment of unity, harmony, oneness, without any kind of parameters or comparison. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then another question, Swami. Yes, what is it? Swami, it's very good. As you say, it is nice. After self-inquiry, I think you are following me. after self-inquiry, after realizing this self, what is going to happen to me? Natural. After getting MSc, what will happen? You will become a lecturer. After getting PhD, what will happen? You will become a professor. So similarly, after self-inquiry, what is going to happen to me? What am I going to become after this? Baba laughed and said, "You are not going to become anything. There is nothing to become also." "Oh, I see. Swami, how?" Baba said, "It seems a parrot made up of sugar, candy, wanted to know the depth of the ocean. So this parrot made up of sugar went close to the ocean and wanted to search how deep it is. In the meantime, it got dissolved. In the meantime, it got dissolved." Similarly, in the process of self-inquiry, you are lost. You are gone. You are one with the vast. You are one with the infinite. You are one with this vast universe. You are one with the cosmos. You are not separate. To say that I this, I got this, I became that, I become that. So that say, those that say I have become that, I got this, they have not got anything other than ignorance. So that we have got to understand very clearly. And then, Swami, one question, please pardon me, Swami. I know that bhajan time is fast approaching, but I don't know whether I would get a chance to put this question again and again. So let me seize this opportunity. One question. Swami, the self is infinite. I am finite. Divinity is so vast, unlimited. I am limited. How the limited know the unlimited? How the finite could know the infinite? Is that possible, Swami? How? I am just limited. How to know that limitless? Baba said, "Look here. It is only the limited that can know the limitless. It is only the finite that can know the infinite. Because there is no question of infinite knowing the infinite. Infinity is one. Therefore, your mind is finite, while self is infinite. With the help of the mind, which is limited or finite, the mind, you should be able to know the self, which is infinite and limitless. So with the help of the limited, you can know the unlimited. The mind, which is limited, should make you experience the self, which is infinite." That's what Bhagavan said. Swami, these days, many people are using two important words, which I don't understand nor find any sense in it. But I cannot dismiss those two words openly because I don't want them to think that I am ignorant of these things. At least I should pretend that I am wise man. May not be so in reality. Two words I often hear, the meaning, the experience I don't have. Would you please explain what they are, Swami? Swami said, "What are those two words? Tell me." One, vibration. The second, inner voice. People speak of these two words, vibration, inner voice. I want to know, Swami, is this inner voice present in everybody? Or is it this whole property of few people? Some people say, "Swami told me this inner voice." Why does he not tell me? Why should he tell you? Do you think that you only have inner voice and I have no inner voice and only outer noise? What do you mean? Is inner voice common to everybody? Are the monopoly a few? And we find some people changing their places. Why? I am not getting good vibrations by seeing. Oh, I see. When you are feeling those vibrations, obviously that I don't feel. So you have vibrations, I am vibrationless. So you are the master of inner voice and I have no voice, much less inner voice. What is all this, Swami? I don't understand. Please kindly explain what it meant. Swami explained in a simple way. I want you to really understand it and appreciate, because nobody has ever given this kind of answer. Well, the body. Body has senses, first level. This what we call conscious. Conscious, meaning the body with senses. Am I clear? There is divinity within every one of us. The individual soul, what you call conscience. Now Baba says, the connecting link between conscious and conscience is vibration. So vibration arises at the meeting point between conscious and conscience, meaning between the body and the individual soul. There you have this vibration. Then inner voice, Swami? Wait, first you understand this, Swami, I understood. Then what is inner voice? The individual soul is conscience, okay? While the cosmic soul, the universal soul, is consciousness. The connecting link between conscience and consciousness is the inner voice. You got the point? So, at the meeting point between the conscience and the consciousness, inner voice arises. Oh, then what is no inner voice in my case? How shall I understand? Bhagavan said, you have not connected your individual soul with the universal soul. You have not connected it. So what am I doing? You have limited yourself. How, Swami? You have a tumbler full of water. All right. Throw out, pour out all the tumbler full of water into the ocean. What will happen? This water and the ocean water become one. Right? So similarly, when the individual soul, the conscience, is one with the cosmic soul, consciousness, in that unity, you hear the inner voice. Because you have limited the water into the tumbler, the individual soul, you remain at the conscience level. You have not gone to the consciousness level. Therefore, you are not able to listen to the inner voice. Am I clear? You don't feel the vibration because you have not connected the conscious, the body, with the conscience, the individual self. Swami, fantastic. Nobody gave this kind of interpretation as of now. Then, Swami, how about certain things being branded good, certain things being branded bad? I don't know. People say this is bad, that is good. What is it? What is good at one time is bad later. What is bad now is good later. What am I to do? Good and bad are relative. Good and bad are relative. You cannot say that's totally bad, this totally good. Who am I to say that? Then Swami says, there's nothing like good and bad. Why? Good and bad are the factors that are decided, that are judged by the mind. It is the mind that decides, it is the mind that distinguishes, it is the mind that differentiates, it is the mind that divides the good and the bad. But spirituality is beyond the mind. Spirituality is beyond the mind, above the mind, transcends the mind. It is transcendental. At that stage there is nothing like good and bad. So Swami, can we have a free life now? There is nothing like good and bad now. So we can have free, jolly life? No. Why? Because you have not crossed your mind. You have not gone beyond the mind. Your mind is full of desires. Enough for 10 lives to come. And you are so egoistic because of your mind. You are so proud because of your mind. You are so possessive because of mind. You are so attached because of your mind. The lust, love, greed, anger, ego, these are all the qualities of the mind. So, you operate at the level of the mind. When you operate at the level of the mind, so long you live, transact with the mind, you have got good and bad. You must follow. When you transcend it, this does not apply. How, Swami? Yes, Jesus Christ, who spoke to good people and sinners also. Sinners. So, to Jesus Christ, there is nothing like a saint and a sinner. Both are same. Because he has gone beyond the state of the mind. So, that's what the example Bhagavan has said. Further, Swami said, all right, whatever may be the vibration, whatever may be the inner voice, I want you all to remember one point. That's what Baba said. What is that point, Swami? Always remember, that which hurts you will hurt anybody. That which makes you happy will make everybody equally happy. So to consider that which is painful, I must know that it is equally painful to everybody. That which gives me pleasure and bliss will make anybody blissful and happy. Therefore, do unto others as you would like to be done by. Therefore, I should treat others in the same way as I would like to be treated. With that day's session concluded, which happens to be the 11th of August. Now this conversation refers to the 12th of August. 12th of August. This year what happened was, Swami came that evening, sat on the chair and started inquiring, how are you, how are you? And then suddenly Swami looked at a boy and said, how is your mother? How is your mother? The boy said, Swami, she is undergoing treatment. Baba immediately remarked, that treatment is not correct. Treatment given to your mother is not correct. She is suffering from kidney problem, which is not diagnosed by doctors. I'll give you Vibhuti Prasadam now. Send her. And that solves the problem. My friends, this is a miracle which I wanted to share with you, which is recorded here. Because of the omniscience of our Bhagavan, though the boy never said that his mother is sick, the boy did not take his seat in the front row. He was far behind. Swami looks at, come here. How is your mother? He says that. That is all-knowing God. We are in the company of all-knowing, all-powerful God. Further, Baba said, take this Vimuti, it will be cured. What does it mean? He knows the cause and the cure. He knows the diagnosis and the treatment. That's why he could tell the boy, the treatment is wrong. The treatment that his, the boy's mother was undergoing at the time was not right. He could say that. Therefore, this is a revelation to everybody. Then, there are few boys sitting in the front row, belonging to the music college. And the boys start singing. And the boys started started singing. Shruti, yavanali meru? English yavantaru? Shruti. S-R-U-T-H-I. Shruti, you know that? One has to adjust to the voice and all that. Any instrument that you play must be in accordance to our tone, right? Shruti. S-R-U-T-H-I. Before the boy started singing, he said the exact meter and asked that fellow who plays an harmonium, that is his wavelength. That is the wavelength of his voice. Come on, adjust to that. The boy was surprised. He didn't start singing. Bhagavan told the fellows, adjust. This is his tone. Adjust to that. Bhagavan is the singer within every one of us. Bhagavan is the song of life. Bhagavan is the voice of everyone. And so he could say that. That's a point which really made me very much surprised at it. This had happened on 13th of August 2003. He asked the music boys to sing. They were singing. And among the four of them, he asked one boy to come close to him. And he said, your voice is not proper. You are suffering from cough. Is it not? Yes, so Swami. Cough, Swami, problem. I say, don't worry. By the wave of his hand, Bhagavan materialized tablets. Tablets I saw there. All of us, not only me, few hundreds of boys saw there on the dais. Take these tablets for 2 days, thrice a day. You will be free from all the problems of the world. Third day, that voice not only got a total cure, but the voice improved, metallic voice. So Swami's curative measure is not simply cure, improvement over the past. Because he's a divine doctor himself. That's what we have seen. And this refers to the 5th of August. Of course, as per the date wise, I should have said it earlier. But the content is important. While Swami coming along the veranda, before occupying his chair, he looked at me and said, why did you speak loudly there? He said, loudly. Why? Swami, where Swami? In the lecture this morning. But what a loud voice it is. Do you think all the people are deaf? Why do you shout like that? That was it. Then I said, Swami, I know my weakness. I am trying to bring down my voice all these years, unsuccessfully. But before, it was very horrible. Now I think it is sufficiently moderate. No. It's still louder. That's what Bhagavan said. And then, this is a kind, but that made me happy because Swami said, why are you looking like this? I said, Swami, my voice may be loud and disturbing. I am happy that you heard my talk. You heard my talk. Therefore, that made you comment. I am quite happy about it. And then, Swami started speaking of this again. All right, you spoke on the unity of religions. I understand. What is the religion? Do you know that? Swami, religion is a path to reach God. He said, you are wrong. So Swami, what is religion now? Religion is love. Religion is love. Oh, I see. Oh. Then Bhagavan said, Swami, is religion love? Yes. To realize that love is the religion, religion is also called realization. Religion is realization. What have you to realize? That religion is love. The realization that love is the religion is the religion. That's what you should have said to those teachers, what Bhagavan has said. Swami, all right, religion of love. Then why so many religions? So many religions are there, Islam, Hinduism and all that. So there is only one religion of love. Then why so many? Then Baba said, if you stop arguing, you will experience unity. The unity of religion can be experienced by stopping argumentation. That is the only way. That's what Bhagavan has said. And then Swami, another question. Then why different interpretations? Catholics, Protestants, Hindus, Shaivites, Vaishnavites. Why so many interpretations? Swami said, it is only for arguments. It is only for arguments. So long you go by the interpretations, so long you go by these narrow paths, you can never experience unity. That's what Bhagavan has said. Swami, one doubt I have. What is it? Bhagavan, people say that Buddhism is atheistic. Buddhism is atheistic. That Buddhists do not believe in God. Am I right? Swami said, no. No. What Buddha says is this. You get message through these senses. You get the message of the scenario through your eyes. You get the message of sounds through your ears. So you get messages from the outer world through these senses. Is it not right? Therefore Buddha says, here only see what is good. Samyak drushti. S-A-M-Y-A-K. Samyak drushti. D-R-U. S-H-T-I. Samyak drishti, good vision. So let the eyes be windows so that all good will be taken in. And what all that you hear, hear what is good. Samyak, S-A-M-Y-A-K. Sravanam, S-R-A-V-A-N-A-M. Samyak Sravanam, good listening. So what Buddhism tells you is to draw the best out of this world through these senses. Not that they are non-believers. Don't say that they are atheists. No. That's what Bhagavan has said, commenting on the Buddhism. And then, here it is also of a interesting point here. Actually speaking, we'll be very much surprised while listening to Swami from time to time, because we'll be under the impression that we know things. But as we hear him, we will know that we do not know. Yes, we will know that we do not know. Till then we think that we know. So my friends, it is absolutely necessary to hear Swami so that we know what it is. Then, I would like to draw your attention. About the time, sir? Okay. I would like to draw your attention to certain other important points also that he said. Yes. Now, Swami, history says that Adi Shankara contradicted, condemned Buddhism. Is that right? Those of you, the students of comparative religions, those of you who are interested in these religions must have come to know and would definitely agree with me that what Adi Shankara says is just to the opposite of what Buddha said. And some of us are also under the impression that Shankaracharya condemned outright the Buddhism. That is the question I have put. Swami said, no. He has not condemned him. He has not contradicted him. Swami, do you mean to say that he supported him? No, I never said it. So Swami, what do you say now? Baba says, he could integrate the Hinduism and the Buddhism. It is a question of integration, it is not a question of contradiction. Adi Shankara could take the spirit of Buddha. Buddha is better explained now. So it's a question of integration, it's not a question of contradiction. That's what Bhagavan has said. And so, look here, the point is this. We will never find Bhagavan condemning any religion. We will never find Bhagavan denying any religion. We will never find Bhagavan speaking low of any religion. On the other hand, he will take them to heights, to exalted heights. That is something great. Swami, about Adi Shankara, I have got one question. Swami said, what is it? Adi Shankara stands for non-dualism. Non-dualism. Non-dualism is a school of philosophy which believes in the ancient wisdom, jnana. Jnana marga, the path of wisdom. Is that true, Swami? Bhagavan immediately said, the same Adi Shankara wrote number of songs and hymns in praise of Goddess. It means what? He followed the path of devotion also. So never say that Adi Shankara supported only wisdom. No. He followed the path of devotion also. And he has composed that beautiful verse, Bhaja Govindam, which is based on the principles of devotion. And finally said, why do you argue like that? Understand that one is a corollary to the other. They are all sequential. A tender fruit gradually develops into unripe fruit. The unripe fruit slowly and slowly turns into ripe fruit. So ripe fruit of today was unripe yesterday. The unripe fruit of yesterday was a tender fruit earlier. So one leads to the other. They are not contradictory. That you should understand. That's what Bhagavan has said. And then slowly students of music college started moving to the front. You know, little boys. People fight there to occupy front rows. So boys are jumping to take the front row. I could get some feeling. Why not ask some questions on music? Why not? Slowly I said, Swami, Raga, R-A-G-A. Raga means tune. Swami, raga or tune is very important for music. And there are two musicians in Andhra Pradesh, very popular. One is Tyagaraja, T-H-Y-A-G-A-R-A-J-A, Tyagaraja. The other composer happened to be Annamacharya, A-N-N-A-M-A-C-H-A-R-Y-A, Annamacharya. These are two great singers from this place. Swami, of the two, who is greater than the other? Mind, what to do? Mind does not accept things as they are. It wants to judge. It wants to estimate. It wants to rate. So my mind is no exception. So Swami, of the two, who is greater than the other? Baba said, Tyagaraja is certainly greater than Annamacharya. Why, Swami? Please follow me. Tune in Sanskrit is called raga. Tune, English. Raga, Sanskrit. But the Sanskrit word raga has another meaning also. Attachment. So raga, the word, Sanskrit word, has two meanings. One, tune, another, attachment. Baba said, Tyagaraja had no raga, no attachment, but only raga, the music part of it, not attachment. He is a viragi, V-I-R-A-G-I. Viragi means detached. Tyagaraja is detached, viragi. But he is known for his raga, the excellent tunes. Whereas Annamacharya, the other popular composer, has got some raga, the attachment with him. Although his ragas, tunes are quite popular. Swami, what a game you have played with this single word raga, making use of the tune and also attachment at the same time. It is only, you only can do it, all can't do it. And then, it is also time when I could ask another important question like this. Swami, is it that Tyagaraja is great because of this viraga detachment? Swami said, not only that. All his compositions are based on his personal experience. Each one of his experiences made him compose a song. Therefore, they have become a legend. Epoch making. That's why Tyagaraja is so great. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then Swami, I know the time is up, Swami. I've got one more question. People speak of so many things like mind, intellect, ego, inner sense. Where are they? If you cut the body, where is ego? You don't see it in the laboratory. In the theater, if you cut the body, where is intellect? You cannot show. Where is the mind? You cannot show. Where is ego? You cannot show. Where are they? What are they? Baba said, all are one, actually. When you think, you call it the mind. When you decide, it is called intellect. When you feel, it is called chitta, C-H-I-T-H-A. Feeling, chitta. When you say, this is mine, when you introduce yourself, I, it is ego, ahankara. So ahankara is ego, I-ness. Chitta is feeling, passion. Manas, M-A-N-A-S, mind, thinking. Buddhi, B-U-D-D-H-I, intellect, decision making. All are same. Depending upon the roles they perform, they are given different names. That's what Bhagavan has said. That's what had happened. Now I take you to the 15th of August, year 2003. It happened to be the Independence Day. Independence Day of India happens to be the 15th of August, which is followed all over the country. There at the college, we had our own function, hoisted the flag, received sweets, and started running to have Bhagwan's darshan. Somehow we came. And the people said, "Sir, darshan is over." That happens even now. What shall I do? But somehow I am sure the Swami will not disappoint us. Alright, please be seated. Let us see. Until Harati, let us wait whether God is going to come or not. Please believe me, Swami came. To the best of my knowledge and experience, Swami never speaks politics. He never supports any single political party, because all party leaders come to him. All need his blessings. All are his children. See? So there's nothing Republican party or Democrat party. Both are his children. So there's nothing like supporting a one political party against the other. Swami never speaks about politics, to the best of my knowledge. But a personal note, I tell you, I begin my day by reading the daily newspaper. My head is full of politics. My head is full of thoughts along the political lines. I'm in the habit of reading paper. Yes, I read it thoroughly. So I know what's happening everywhere. However well I'm trying to corner Bhagawan, number of times I made attempt to make him speak on politics, make him comment on politics. Well, I failed utterly. He was just, I see, good, I see. That's all, no comment. Swami in that stage, that is happening, good. Swami here is there, I see. So, my idea was to corner him somewhere or that. What he has to say on this point? No. Why? Bhagawan speaks of democracy in a different sense. Equality, not in terms of exercise of franchise or voting. Equality of humanity. Equality of humanity. Equanimity of the mind. Bhagawan speaks of democracy in terms of sentiments and feelings and ideologies. Bhagawan refers to the kingdom of heaven which is in our heart. Where is the kingdom of heaven? It is in our heart. Seek ye the kingdom of heaven, everything shall be added unto you, says the Holy Bible. Where is the kingdom of heaven? It is in our heart. Bhagawan wants you to be the king of your own kingdom. But we are slaves. We want to be democratic, but we don't have equal mindedness. We don't have the spirit of equality. All this is only for political purpose. So it is my foolishness to have put questions on politics. Well, I could not do it. Anyhow, Swami, you like political leaders like Tilak, T-I-L-K, a great man, Bose, B-O-S-E, freedom fighters, Swami, who struggled for independence of this country. Now he could not control himself. Yes, why, Anil Kumar, I know what you want. Now I tell you in simple sentence. Independence, split both the words. Independence. when you are in dependence, you are a slave. When you are independent, you are a master. So be independent to be a master. But if you are in dependence, you are a slave. Swami, very good, very good. I am extremely happy. Because being a dependent, you have to look for others' help every moment for everything. So, for any individual, for any institution, for any nation, independence is important. All right. Still 5 minutes more for bhajan time. Having failed all the earlier attempts, I could get only one sentence, dependence and independence. Okay. But still, Swami, yes, it seems in your younger days, you have composed few songs in praise of this country. Patriotic songs you have composed at an young age. He said, so what? Swami, roughly, how old are you at that time? Roughly. What was your age at that time when you composed patriotic songs? Do you know what Baba said? My age at that time? You say in my younger days? How can I say? I am ageless. How can I say my age? I am ageless. I am eternal. So I cannot tell my age. That's what Bhagwan has said. Though my intention is to drag him to political field, but has taken me to spiritual heights. He has taken me to spiritual heights by revealing himself that is beyond time and space. So conversation with Swami is not only a matter of pleasure and revelation, but at the same time it is quite risky and challenging, but worth taking it. Yes, because we will be benefited ultimately. That's all what all had happened during the month of August.
Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Govinda Gopala, He Nandalala, Govinda Gopala, He Nandalala, Govinda Gopala, He Nandalala, Govinda Gopala, He Nandalala, Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Nida ke Nath Prabhu Murali Gopala, Hey Murali Gopala, Nida ke Nath Prabhu Murali Gopala, Govardhano Dhar Gopala Bala, Govardhano Dhar Gopala Bala, Govardhano Dhar Gopala Bala, Hey, Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Govinda Gopala He Nandalala, Govinda Gopala He Nandalala, Govinda Gopala He Nandalala, Govinda Gopala He Nandalala, Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Radhe Gopala, Gopi Gopala, Nida ke Nath Prabhu Murali Gopala, Nida ke Nath Prabhu Murali Gopala, Murali Gopala, Gopala, Govardhana Dhara Gopala Dhara Govardhana Dhara Gopala Dhara Govardhana Gopala Dhara Tomorrow we'll be meeting. Same time. Good night. Hare Om.